Book of Jika now translated. Translation by Christine Preston. Christine.
My translation of what I call the Book of Jika, for which no English version previously existed, has been available in my work, From the Words of Angels and Ancient Book of Jika since 2012. The source I have translated it from is a text published in the book On the Paranormal by Jimmy Gu. This French author had a passionate interest in ufology. He gained recognition for hundreds of science fiction novels, the earliest of which were published in the 1950s.
Acknowledgement.
Jimmy Gu gave me permission to publish my translation of this manuscript in 1997 because I worked with him for about 3 years. He was keen to make it available to the English-speaking world. As he died in 2000, his wife, Lucia, has confirmed the copyright permission by a telephone call that Mr. Jean-Luc Rivera, the editor of La Gazette 14, made on her behalf. My special thanks are therefore due to Lucia and this messenger. The Book of Jika is from a tradition handed down from one generation to another in Spain, and from what is believed to be an original manuscript in Aramaic that was translated into Arabic, Greek, Latin, Old Spanish, and Old French. The French version probably derived from an Arab version that found its way back in Spanish, and then French in about 1830. Lige Andelsall, the owner of the document, stated to Jimmy Gu that it had been the property of her family for generations. She had a genealogical tree going back to a certain King Marshal, an Arab enemy of Charlemagne named in La Chanson de Roland, the Song of Roland. This ancient work is one of the first prose stories written in the French language in the medieval age. Lige Ain claimed that a certain Smail bin Hassan, an Arab poet, was also one of her ancestors. Spain was, of course, conquered by the Arabs. It was known in Lige Ain's family that the original manuscript was not medieval, but more ancient, and that it was in fact written in Aramaic on thin sheets of gold. It is one of the languages of some fragments of the Book of Enoch discovered at Qumran, and the tongue spoken by Jesus Christ 2,000 years ago. The French text is poetic and its style reminiscent of the Bible. It has a few expressions such as "and behold" like those in the Bible and Book of Enoch. There are parallels between these religious works and the manuscript, so where the French states "Master of Masters," I could have used the expression "Lord of Lords" as in the Book of Enoch, but have chosen the closer literal option. The term master has also been used in the Egyptian emerald tablets of Thoth, that appears to contain parallel statements. The numbers in front of each paragraph are not in the French source. I have added them to introduce to my translation a numeric system of reference similar to the one used in the Bible. The importance of this manuscript consists in the fact that its story of love affairs between sky gods and earth-born women is parallel to the intermarriages mentioned in Genesis 6 between the sons of God and daughters of man. The document is a testament in which Jika states he was the grandson of an extraterrestrial wing being who had dominion of the whole earth in an age of decline. Jika, who is the author of the manuscript, departs from his homeland prior to its destruction by a veil of water. He doesn't say what it was called, but it seems clear enough that it was the legendary Atlantis. We shall see that the land where he then settles down may be identified as Egypt. The manuscript of Jika is the legacy of an antediluvian ruler who claims to be the grandson of Samurzaru Kadil-Heliohib, an initiator who had come from distant stars to teach man in line 11. What is said of Samurza, the great initiator, is that he decided not to return to his home planet of some distant part of deep space, as he elected to remain on Earth. It is stated that some of his companions remained with him. The French term used for space was the sky, le ciel, and the term used for the homeworld that he elected not to return to was Earth but in the sense of planet. Heliohim is a term reminiscent of Elohim, the Hebrew term translated as God in Genesis, but with a spelling from the Greek term helios meaning the sun, perhaps because the story is part of a solar tradition. The account states that the sons of the sun were not of this world. In the New Testament, Jesus Christ made a claim using the same phraseology, but it is generally understood in theology in the sense of not of this material world. Emerging from the document is the information that Jika was born of Jimki, the son of Samurzaru Kadil-Heliohib, an extraterrestrial winged god, who had come from distant stars to teach men. Samurza was therefore Jika's grandfather. Like Hercules in the Greek legends and Gilgamesh, in the Sumerian ones, Samurza is portrayed as a semi-divine being and a son of the sun. We are informed that before the arrival of the extraterrestrial instructors, the Earth was populated by an indigenous race that already possessed a government, as has been said of the Titans. When most of these initiators returned to their home planet, Samurza Rukatl decided to remain on Earth because of his relationship with Aphila, the daughter of a master of the whole inhabited Earth. However, Samurza took over the rule of the entire inhabited Earth. Aphila belonged to an Earth-born race that Jika calls perverse. The marriage of Samurza Rukatl with Aphila is parallel to that of divine beings with Earth-born Atlanteans, or Titans. It is a time when two races share the world between each other. Aphila gave birth to a son who did not have wings like his father, Samurza. This son was called Jumki. He was Jika's father. Samurza had built the Great Pyramid that supported the Temple of the Universe. In the earliest days it was a temple forbidden to the perverse race, and inside it was a sacred chamber where all wisdom progressed in the divine science. The pyramid was called the Rock that Dominates. Priestesses born of the Earth race officiated in this temple, as the sky gods shared it with some among the indigenous race. The reason Jika calls himself Master is that he inherited the title from his father. He inherited dominion over the mighty ones of the perverse race, and, as a result, they bowed down to him. But then, tragedy struck. The perverse race massacred the infants that the sons of the sun had from their affairs with the daughters of man. Jika mentions the cataclysmic convulsions that submerged his homeland by a veil of water. He left before they took place and reached a city beyond the ocean where mummification was practiced. He refers to a time in his life when he was 700 years old. In Jika's story, the sky gods are heavenly, and the race of man is portrayed as perverse, impious, blinded in spirit, and barbaric. Earthborn men have no consideration for their female companions. They treat their wives like slaves and violate the law of Trinity decreed by the sky gods. The fact that earthborn men had more than one child with more than a woman, and even their wives' maids, as they were polygamous, was regarded as decadent by the sons of the sun, but they became outnumbered. The perverse race rebelled and grew in number, then, the divine sons lost control because they were fewer in number. The perverse race became jealous because their rulers, the sons of the royal species, lived much longer, so they plotted to exterminate the progeny the sky gods had with the daughters of the perverse race. In a period of decline, under the rule of a great prince, the perverse race took over the temple of the sons of the gods. The perverse race exterminates the hybrids and creates a law of species that is found in the Book of Enoch as a divine law prohibiting intermarriages with the sons of heaven. According to Enoch, this law existed in the generation of his father, Jared. There are two types of watchers in Enoch. One group is said to have been corrupted on earth because they entered into relationships with the daughters of men as the sons of men do by taking to themselves wives. This is the minor scenario, and it may reflect a view that is more recent than the time of the watchers. The other group of watchers are part of the main scenario in which they are criticized for having corrupted the earth. Enoch seems to have mixed them up and put the two groups in the same bag because they were extraterrestrial. Enoch tells us that heaven sent archangels to bind the group that corrupted the earth, mainly because the secrets they had revealed led to a misuse of power. In the 19th century, scholars recognize that the sons of God of Genesis 6, who were a parallel to the watchers, were divine and angelic due to the use of the term Bene Elohim everywhere else in the Old Testament. They recreated a dilemma that had been forgotten because the watchers of Enoch were portrayed as evil. They never solved it because they didn't notice there was a difference between the two groups of watchers. It may have arisen in the original decipherment. In this story, the sky gods become the victims of the barbaric, perverse, and impious earthborn race. Before Jika's homeland is submerged, his beloved is kidnapped and tied in wedlock to Haman in a ritual described as involving the drinking of the sacred water of the well. This ritual is said to be binding like a marriage vow, but the sacred water is a metaphor for the use of the sacred fire that descends from the divine God presence, compared here to a well, during the sexual act. Jika describes, indeed, that his beloved was violently thrown upon Haman's nuptial bed and raped. After this, Jika admits he has lost the heart of a divine son, as he has become unforgiving. He wishes to take revenge upon the damned race. It will be his downfall. He will be trapped in the wheel of reincarnations. Like Noah, who escapes the flood with members of his family, Jika takes refuge in another land before his world is destroyed by water. Jika speaks of a son in his flesh as if he had knowledge of genetics. He links goodness to the genes of the sons of heaven. He sets in motion a series of causes and effects for his reincarnations to take shape in the future by the spoken word and mental thought forms. He alludes to the use of the third eye and magic to bring about the materialization of desired circumstances. This practice has a parallel in Memphite theology in the statement that every divine word came into being through that, which was thought by the heart, and commanded by the tongue. This reflects the idea that thoughts were taking shape, that situations could be commanded to crystallize, and that careless words could result with karmic retribution in the future. Situations were born of the alterations of the divine speech that the Egyptians called tongue. In exile, the last of the sky gods eventually reject the original laws under the prince of the earth's rule. Jika does not, but accepts to father a son with the daughter of this prince. It is from the latter that follows a genealogy within which the Jika author of the manuscript states he reincarnated in every Jika born of the fourth generation. He states, "I shall always be born of my own blood, in the fourth generation, in the rebirths of life." He was still alive by the time a son born of the third generation was an adult. Jika does have something in common with Hermes Trismegistos, who knew himself as thrice great. This seems to mean that he remembered two of his previous incarnations. The first Hermes was Thoth. According to the Egyptians, he was the inventor of writing, the author of theological and magical writings, as well as a teacher of certain secret techniques that were taught and used in temples. In addition to the obvious similarity that the winged ancestors of Jika have with the angels of Christianity, an Eastern parallel for Jika is a certain Jyotisha, a legendary character believed to have been one of the seven sons of Manu. Jyotisha has been identified as Uranos, the first king of Atlantis. Uranos also means sky in Greek. Uranos preceded the ruler known to the Greeks as Kronos and as Saturn to the Romans. Jyotisha is a Sanskrit word of Himalayan origin meaning lords of light, that is linked to beings of light, such as devas and deities. In the esoteric sense it means the inner light of the spirit. Jyotisha also is one of the many names of Brahma. The Jyotis were mentioned as teachers of astronomy in the Matsya Puranas. According to a legend concerning the Jyotis, Jyotisha gave birth to titans who mutilated him. This symbolic mutilation appears to correspond to the extermination of the progeny of the intermarriages in Jika's manuscript. It has been said of the titans that they procreated sexually when creation by will ceased to take place in a primordial time. Jika's age fits in well with this time of mutation as the text refers to the appearance of a phallic symbol when men were belittled in the flesh and blinded in spirit. A statement alludes to a connection between the names Adam and Dama. The latter would have been an ancient name for the sentient being that we now call Terra, or Gaia, and the power of sound, that a race of beings in a process of degeneration used, could have produced a mutation, as well as sexual reproduction. Jika indeed states, "In those days, the earth was called Dama. Her decadent sons received a sign, Adam is phallus, and the Adam was born of the alterations of the divine tongue." Scholars have suspected the name Adam is in connection with the soil that Genesis states man was created from. The manuscript of Jika. Jika.
In those days, the gods came to earth. Samir's Arau cattle Heliaheim was their leader. They came from those regions not of this world, to teach men. As soon as it was time to do so, they went back, but Samir's Arau cattle Heliaheim did not. He was in love with the king's daughter who had given him a son. A few of his companions remained with him. He became the master of the entire inhabited earth. It was him who built the great pyramid that supported the temple of the universe, to pay homage to the sun that was the sign of the race. And behold, in those already distant days of the sons of the sun, I was the mightiest among the ancient ones of the nation and of the race, as well as the master and living symbol of all powers. The name of my ancestors evoked the majestic heights from which streamed forth impetuous torrents. I was the first rock of the rock that dominates. And behold, the noble metal gleamed on the walls of my residence, in the hanging gardens of which there were singing birds. My name was Jika, and my eyes, carved in the magnificent vault of the sky, could withstand the glare of the gods' splendor without any strain, for behold, the fatherly sun provided for us abundantly. Although my forehead was adorned with youth, it concealed the science of old people. I was the one who prophesied the dark night of the world and the abominations of the impious race. And behold, I had access to the forbidden temple, the sacred chamber where all wisdom progressed in the divine science. I was the master, and also a master. And behold, in this remote time, two races of men shared the world between each other, that of the sons of the sun, divine and pure but in decline, and that of man, belittled in the flesh, and blinded in spirit. In those days, the earth was called Dama. Her decadent sons received a sign, Adam as phallus, and the Adam was born of the alterations of the divine tongue. Our lovers were queens. They gave birth in joy to one daughter only in their perfect image, or to one male child only in the image and likeness of man. And man was also king. That was our law on the basis of the divine Trinitarian principle. Our pure love affairs between pure ones were not to be conceived outside of the unutterable Trinity. The fatherly star, lover of the sublime mother, made her fertile with the single life that is life throughout all universes. In those days, the sons of the gods entered into their agony, the sun lost his brightness and he limited his gifts. And behold, the sign of the beast had appeared. We were a people of noble root, but little spread. The privileged part of the world that was our cradle became our tomb, on the day written down as the one when everything would die under the sun. In those days, the sons of man chose some companions among the daughters of their race. And they said, "These are our wives." They married, according to their laws, by the means of public rituals. And behold, their wives became their servants and their wives' mates also became their wives. And this perverse race increased in their violation of the law of the Trinitarian principle, despite the pain of the curse, because this is what happened. They procreated in numbers and we were overwhelmed by their numbers. Then the sons of the impious race nursed the desire to exterminate the divine sons of the sun. Hate appeared at the same time as the decline of the light. Indeed, the fatherly star became yellow, harvests became poorer, and most people had to perform degrading labors. Then thistle and bramble grew increasingly upon the soil of the gods and rye grass choked the sacred grain. There were trees without fruit, plants without flowers, and also venom and evil came about. And behold, the royal breed died out in the decadence of its divine customs. The shadow of death was upon it and its days were cut short, whereas the strength of life swelled the flesh of the sons of man. Then far away did my voice spread the hope of resurrection in the hour written down as the one, when every extinct thing should rise again under the sun in the glory of life. For behold, the divine monarch of the light always restitutes to everyone their bones, flesh and breaths by all the lives of life. But the sons of the gods came to lament in front of my ramparts, in distress. They did not drink from the pure comforting springs, and their souls were tormented with anguish. Then the sacred temple was handed over to the perverse race. Their daughters worshipped there the image of man and iniquity. Sanctuaries were then stained with the revolting fat of sacrifices and of the blood of sacrificial rams. And behold, I was the mightiest of the race, the last of the most ancient ones, Jika Oris, son of Jimki, and my brothers were also born of Jimki, the latter being son of Samir's Arau cattle Heliahim, the one who had come from distant stars to teach man. Behold, he had, however, not gone back to the fertile earth of his ancestors because he had found love with Ophala, the daughter of the master of the entire inhabited earth. Ophala gave him a son. He did not have wings like his glorious father. And behold, Samirza, the great initiator of the other race, united himself to the daughter of man because she was beautiful, and he repudiated the earth situated in some distant parts of the sky. A few of his companions remained with him. And behold, he became the master of all the inhabited earth. He was the one who built the great pyramid that supported the temple of the sun during his lifetime. It was called the rock that dominates. And behold, the history of my fathers, sons of the sun, is as follows: because I, Jika, son of Jimki, am of their race and of their blood. He founded the wonderful city of Ophelir, in honor of Ophela, his lover, and he drank of the water of the sacred well. No one stroked me, no law forced me to return to my father's residence, and the highest among the mighty ones of the perverse race bowed down in the dust in front of me. For behold, I was the first rock of the rock that dominates, the master, and the living symbol of all power. In those days, the daughters of man were still coming to the beds of the sons of the sun, and the sons of the sun knew them in the bliss of the flesh in the ways of their race. In those days there was unity. And behold, unity died out with the royal species. And the daughters of man, in disdain of the perverse sons, their brothers, were seeking the wonders of the flesh on the beds of the sons of the gods. And the daughters of man, in violation of the law of the Trinitarian principle, were giving to the sons of the sun children of a race that was still beautiful and good, famous giants as beautiful as the divine star, before they were submerged by a veil of water. And behold, the masters of the damned race feared that the sons of the sun escape, in their descendants, from the ruling of death that is the fate of all people in all ages and all worlds. So, those of the perverse race met in the temple of the lower city with young men and women. They promulgated the law of species, and the daughters of their own blood, who were kept away from the sons of the gods, were punished through their male children as they were put to death straight away. As a result of the spilled blood, there was a rebellion cry in the world, and man became man's enemy. Some male children who had their throat cut were buried on high grounds. The innocents were massacred in all the kingdoms of the corrupt race, because those innocents were born of our affairs. In those days, the daughters of man lacerated their faces in the depth of their pain. The daughters of man cried endlessly around my walls. I went to them to appease their torments with comforting words. And behold, I was not one of those who had begotten a child with one of the daughters of man. None of them, whether mothers or children, were avenged. Yet we did not forge impure metal. We did not strike anyone with murderous intent. Our ways were peaceful. Adna, a daughter of man, picked up the body of a young child among the numerous corpses around the sacred temple. And behold, the youth was Adna's sister, and she was at an age when feet are untied to set a virgin free. Now, behold, the virgin child had gone back to the eternal light, by the murderous sword, with the companion of her games hardly Nubal, and behold, the latter had lost his life in the massacre while protecting her. My heart bled tears of blood for the virgin in the agonies of my affliction, and for the young man despite the anathema decreed upon Atna, daughter of man, by myself, Jika, son of the gods. Behold, this was because Atna had denounced Svaha, my beloved, to the perverse men of the damned race. The damned race had then taken the birthright. Without fear it had raised the sword to strike its divine brothers, but did not attack my walls. In those days, we still shared the temple of the sun, and the priestess of the fire used to meet me there at the entrance of the first chamber in front of Atna. Atna, who was her companion, was a priestess in the temple of the sun. The law of species had been unable to untie our yoke, and Svaha, my beloved, daughter of man, the most beautiful among the virgins of that race, was not afraid in my presence because, behold, I was Jika, son of Jimki, the latter being the son of Samir's Araucattle Heliaheim, the first rock of the rock that dominates. Then, we swore by the ancestral star in eternity not to be ashamed of it. We swore by our lives and our blood that we would not have any progeny in any place, nor in any time, in the ages before the divine race would be raised again under the sun. And behold, in our father's residence, I came to Svaha, my beloved, my pure. And my beloved was with me in the bliss of the flesh in the ways of my race. And behold, there was no child to betray the secret of our divine passions, because as always in times of iniquity, Svaha, my beloved, my pure, became sterile, because all thoughts of the sons of the sun were taking shape. Then Atna, my companion, and a daughter of man, became jealous. The torments of love inhabited her heart and her soul was lost in the night. Atna went to the temple of the lower city and spoke against Jika, Oris, the first rock of the rock that dominates. And behold, she spoke against Svaha, the daughter of the highest among the mighty ones among the men of the perverse race. Then the mighty ones and the ancients trembled in their hearts. And behold, Haman, the cruelest of our persecutors, proclaimed an edict against me, because Svaha, my beloved, had scorned him. And behold, in those days, led by Atna, Haman met Svaha, my beloved, in front of the fountain of pure waters where she was forced to drink of the sacred water of the fountain, and they were joined. Then my beloved was taken from me, and she was thrown like a prey upon Haman's nuptial bed, son of her race. She became his companion. The soul of my beloved was in rebellion due to her shame. And Atna, in the joy of her triumph, placed on my wound the gall of her treason. Happiness was washed out of my heart with my tears. Then I became the fiercest enemy of the corrupt race. I made an oath to the face of the fatherly star to tear away my beloved from the shameful bed, no matter how long this would take, and however hard this would be. And behold, I also made an oath to strike the woman guilty of betrayal, because I had lost the heart of a divine son. I had the heart of a man who was hardened by pain, and such a man has no inclination to forgiveness. Then I took Atna in my house with all the artifices of love. And behold, she became my lover in violation of the law of species. And behold, I made her slave of the delights of the flesh in the ways of the divine customs of the sons of the sun. And behold, I sent her away from my sight, and abandoned her to her feelings of remorse by the torments of her days and her nights set ablaze. Then, I, Jika, son of Jimki, son of Samir's Araucattle Heliaheim, the winged god who came from a world among the stars, I, the mightiest among the high priests of the caste, declared a condemnation literally, carried a condemnation upon my head. I said, "Woe to you, Atna, daughter of man, because you have denounced my beloved." And in the excess of her grief, Atna fell as dead in front of me. For behold, I, Jika, said, "Woe to you, priestess of the temple of the Sunday. You will never forget in all the lives that you live, throughout all races and places, the divine lover, the son of the gods." All thoughts were indeed taking shape. I did not have any pity for her love, although it was great and powerful, I had contempt for it. And so the woman who had betrayed Svaha, my beloved, my dove, to the perverse men of the impious race, will always come to me to beg for my respect. For behold, I want her on my bed filled with grief, tasting 100 times, or 720 times, of the bitter cup of my beloved, until the hour of forgiveness. Then the divine light flooded my night, O Jika! O Master of Masters! O living symbol! Behold, you have uttered careless words. O semi-divine God and mortal of the superb race! Now you have created in form, as behold, Atna will now forever be your second lover in consequence of your will. For behold, she will use as a stepping stone your beloved's faults, and the solitude of your soul will be to her a well-strengthened weapon. I was engulfed in darkness once again. I knew no rest between my two lovers. I lost all joy, I could not smile. Sadness became my companion and tears wetted my face. And behold, in those days, the time of calamity came about. Then my voice was heard calling the sons of the sun to resignation, "Behold, you will perish and so will our divine customs, our temples and our sacred science. For behold, the earth belongs to the perverse race, to her damned sons, and their abominations will cause perturbation for the stars in the dark ages. But do not fear, their decline will come, at the appointed hour, and the sons of the light will prepare the return of the sons of the gods." Then we left for the other side of the world, my beloved in her solitude far from me, and I with my noble friend, his lover, our friends and our servants with children of a tender age and our friends' servants, as well as animals and precious belongings. We reached beautiful and fertile grounds where the men of the perverse race had built wonderful cities, their customs still being divine. And behold, I did not erect any house on distant soil. I reached, beyond the ocean, a royal city with golden doors. There I settled down. There I lived among the wise ones of the inferior race, and behold, I instructed them. There, Svaha, my beloved, that time had given me back with her shame, closed her eyes. And her body did not know corruption. For behold, I placed aromatics in her entrails, the silver plate in her mouth, and for a shroud a bed of perfume. And behold, no foreign hand to mine carried out the death ritual. And behold, I placed a scarlet flower upon her bosom. Then a great terror struck a part of the earth. All of the divine kingdoms disappeared in the waters in fury, and the world became possessed by the sons of darkness. And behold, I was the mightiest among the exiled people of my caste, and at the hour of the last great convulsions, Atna, my enemy, came and begged me for my forgiveness. And behold, tormented in her soul under the weight of her crime, she went down on her knees in front of me. But I did not forgive. I weighed Atna's repentance. I kept the guilty one in my house because of words of carelessness, because of my solitude. For behold, the last sons of the gods, saved from the murderous waters, my friends and my servants, had joined themselves to the daughters of men. Hence their sons' progeny had damned children. Then, they rejected our laws. They bowed in the presence of the impious great prince and accepted his domination. I was alone, my head high. I did not fail, but I wept in solitude. Now, Atna had become the companion of loneliness to pay off her crime. In those days, Atna returned inside the divine essence. And behold, in the time my life reached 700 years, the great prince came to me. The great prince ordered me to leave a son of my race, one who would devote himself to our science, and who would be able to read from the sacred texts. In view of the perverse man's power, I, Jika, son of Jimki, son of Samir's Araucatl Heliahim, obeyed. My heart was not moved when the child cried for the first time. The great prince brought him up in his palace, far from any spectators. Now behold, his mother was the daughter of the great prince. Then many days went by and I remained in my solitude in the midst of this foreign nation. The great prince assigned me, in front of all of his court and his dignitaries, to the education of his daughter's son, who was born of my blood. I, Jika, the last of the divine sons of the sun, placed in the mind of the child born of my blood, rejected by my heart, the science of my ancestors. And behold, I corrupted the texts, I did not divulge the secrets. The child was brought up with all the pomp of the palace. He was afraid of me and kept my instructions because of his fears. Then, the mighty ones of the nation called him Jika of the rock that dominates. They mocked him because of his birth. For behold, they showed him in front of the whole court of the great prince and said, "This is the son of the last god." In those days, any man born of divine affairs was the object of disgrace, and any son of the sun, subjected to an edict, went to the desert to live in the midst of the solitudes. And behold, the son of my blood worked with iron. He had a son and called him Jika, to respect my law, because of his fears. Then his son fought against the kings, but did not fight against the nations. After behold, Jika, son of Jika, had a son whom he called Jika. This son, the third generation after me, son of the gods, refused to work with iron but held iron in his hand. Then I, Jika, the last of the pure descendants from Samir's Araucatl Heliahim, the one who came from distant stars, asked Jika, born of the third generation, to come and see me. He was good. I placed my divine crown, literally, headband, upon his forehead. I placed my hand upon his head. He was noble and I anointed him. And behold, I shall always be born of my own blood, in the fourth generation, in the rebirths of life. And behold, thoughts were taking shape. So, I mapped the path of my race across Jika's posterity, son of gods, as well as son of man, and of daughters of man, descendant of the last son of the sun, brought up in the presence of the great prince. But I did not love the woman who carried him in her womb. And behold, I made a call for the lives, in all the lives of life, to the divine monarch of light, who shines in the skies. I shall remain awake in the night. I shall forever be the best of the sons of my blood, according to my will, and the law of the lives of life. I am high priest and master among masters. Then I shall carry the sign of my race in my flesh. The memory will shine in spirit, in the fourth gift of life. Behold, I come. And Svaha, my beloved, my dove, will be given back to me, and will follow my footsteps with my second lover, because of the careless words. And behold, shuddering with fear, son of my blood, you the fourth and at the same time myself, you the messenger, unique and at the same time my shadow, and my soul and the remote seed that will rise at the hour of the great convulsion. For behold, you will be shaking with horror at the thought of the clash of the two enemy races, one being that of the sons of the earth, who made it in iniquity and will defile, in times to come, the virgin and the child, and the other being the race of the sons of the sun, who loved divinely and had a sacred science those sons who will come back at the time written down, to establish their code upon a world in commotion.
The child is the man-child of Revelation 12, that the dragon was ready to devour. It is a reference to the birth of Christ consciousness in mankind.
Then, keep the flame of hope burning in your heart, even in days of affliction. The dawn of our resurrection is approaching. Behold, the sons of darkness will be outnumbered in their turn by the sons of the light, but blood will not be shed. And behold, the law of species will also separate them from the new race and take them to the abyss of death. And behold, they will be no more. The kingdom of the earth will belong to the gods who will come from distant stars. When you forget yourself, Atna, forgiveness will be granted due to your sublime renunciation, through your love for Jika, the first rock, the divine lover son of gods, and master among the masters. Peace will descend in you, master of masters, in the generosity of this forgiveness, the words of carelessness will be no more. And behold, Svaha, my beloved, will be the only one to reign alone throughout the lives of my life, next to me. Then there will be beauty. Then will the love of the gods blossom again. And for you, Atna, there will be forgiveness and glory. Always watch over my walls so that no tears ever flood your face. And behold, I am Jika, the first rock of the rock that dominates and the master of the masters, son of Samir's Araucattle Heliahim, the winged god who came, in the days of old, from far off stars with his companions to teach the people of the earth. And behold, I am eternal. I know and I carry the secret of the worlds, and I leave to my descendants the prophecy of the semi-divine God who was, through my own self, master of masters. And behold, all this will therefore cause the world to be terror-stricken in times to come, a time of calamities before my brothers, the gods, the sons of the King of Kings, approach the ground in convulsion.
End.
Christine.
This dark prophecy is in relation to our present age, and would have been the harvest of ancient sowings, but prophecies are never set in stone and calamities have been avoided.